Hey all, my name is Prashant Kumar, or PK, and I'm an MCAT tutor at Shemmassian Academic Consulting. Today, we're going to be doing a passage walkthrough in the MCAT Chem Phys section. You should be taking roughly 6.5 minutes on this passage, but today, we're going to be going more in depth so you can see exactly what's going on in my head as I tackle this section. Let's get it. All right, great. So I've gone ahead and put the passage on the left and the questions are going through on the right. So feel free to take a moment, pause the video, and come back to us when you're ready. If not, let's get right into talking strategy. For me, I like to maintain the same strategy going into any passage. The reason for this is it keeps me grounded and gives me something that boosts my confidence. Regardless of whether the passage is super easy or super challenging, I know I have something to come back to. This strategy for me looks like read a paragraph, write a quick 3 to 5 word summary, then go on to the next paragraph, on and on and on. Doing this quick 3 to 5 word summary provides a lot of accountability, making sure I understand exactly what's going on in the paragraph before moving on to the next one. Oftentimes I'd find myself sort of reading an entire passage, getting lost, not really understanding what's going on. But when you do that paragraph by paragraph breakdown and understand with that summary exactly what's going on, the whole narrative makes so much more sense. And so that's a high yield tip of reading a passage. My second tip is if figures come up, I don't like to spend too much time on them on my first read. The reason for this is we don't know what questions, if any, will be asked about these figures. So why would we waste time beforehand if we're eventually gonna have to come back and look at the figures if they come up? So with that, those are my main high-yield tips for how to break down a passage, and we can get right into reading this one. Researchers are studying the reflection of radioactive particles off of mirrors in a novel study. To generate radioactive beta particles, a radioactive 15C isotope with an 11-minute half-life is used. The radioactive particles are concentrated into a single beam using a series of slits in an electromagnetic field. After concentration, the particles with the desired path are focused toward a mirror at a range of angles. All right, so the question I always ask myself in these situations is, what's happening, right? And I don't want all the details. There's always gonna be a bunch of details, but I want a big picture understanding of exactly what's going on. And so if you can boil it down into 3 to 5 simple words, symbols, whatever you need to do to get that message across, that's all we need. And so here, all we're looking at is radioactive particles going to mirrors with electromagnetic. So that's what I'm saying. It's a quick 3 to 5 word summary. You can use abbreviations, symbols, whatever you need. No one else other than you is going to be reading these 3 to 5 words. So make sure that you make sense to you, not anyone else. And with that, let's go right on to the next paragraph. The beta particles make contact with the mirror, and the angle at which the particles are reflected is measured by observing the point of contact of the beta particle with a counting surface and the time it takes for the beta particle to reach the counting surface. In this experiment, the counting surface contains a molecule that can react specifically with the beta particle to detect its presence. In addition, the counting surface is located at a fixed distance away from the initial point of contact along a vertical plane. All right, so again, big picture question, what's happening? And here, all we're doing is beta particle measurements, right? That's the big picture understanding. I haven't seen most of these terms in my content review or my practice questions, right? We've maybe seen beta particles because that's nuclear chemistry, but we haven't seen all these other things like counting surfaces or fixed distance away from a vertical plane. Like these types of things haven't come up in our exact sort of content phase. And so if we look at this paragraph, we just identify it as beta particle measurements. We can come back if we need to, but if not, let's just go right into the next paragraph. After conducting a series of measurements using the radioactive 15C isotope, researchers test several additional isotopes. In experiment 2, researchers want to develop a system to detect the reflection of alpha particles. All right, so what's happening? And here, We have isotope testing. And why are we doing the isotope testing? To look at alpha particles in the future. So that's the idea. It's like we're setting it up where we're talking about sort of an experimental setup. We want to look at how it relates to beta particles and whether we can use this to relate to alpha particles. That's the big picture of the entire sort of narrative of this passage. But with that, we've knocked out the passage. Let's get right into the questions. All right. Question number one. Assuming that the reflected beta particles follow the law of reflection, which of the following best represents the angle that the beta particles will be reflected from the mirror if the angle of incidence is 38 degrees? All right, so a lot of key terms that you need to focus in on right here, right? One of them is that we're looking at reflected beta particles following the law of reflection. And so what that means is that if we have sort of a mirror surface right here, we're going to be sending this sort of light ray in, and what's going to happen to it is that it's going to be reflected. And now the important thing of the law of reflection is that we call this the incidence ray, right? What the light coming in is coming at a specific angle, and we set this angle to be perpendicular to our surface or our mirror. And this angle, we'll say theta, is called the angle of incidence, right? And that's what's mentioned right here. The angle of incidence is 38 degrees. And so what the law of reflection says is that when we're dealing with mirror that's being light ray that's being reflected, it's going to reflect at the same angle away from this. I'll put that in red, actually. So you can see. All it's saying is that this new reflected angle is going to be the same exact thing. In this case, theta equals theta 2, right? The black angle is the same as the red angle. And that's a very, very important tenet of the law of reflection. When a light ray is being reflected, those angles are going to be equal. So in this case, we know that the angle of incidence is 38 degrees. So our angle of reflection is going to be also 38 degrees, right? If it goes in at one angle, it's reflected at the exact same angle as the angle of incidence. And this is a really important fact, so I want you to hammer that in. And with that, we're one for one, and we're going on to question number two. All right. A researcher begins with 1 gram of 15C. After 33 minutes, how much 15C does the researcher have remaining? A, 500 milligrams, B, 250 nanograms, C, 150 nanograms, or D, 125 milligrams. All right, right away from reading the answer choices, right, we're gonna have to focus in on what? Milligrams and nanograms. We have different sort of units, and so just always be careful of this. With that, we need to reckon that this has to do with some sort of time period and half-life that we've talked about earlier, right? When we see something after a certain number of minutes or when we begin with a certain amount of substance, how much is left, we usually think half-life. And we're going to look back at where in our passage we talked about half-lives, right? And here it says 15C, an isotope with an 11-minute half-life is used. All right, great. And so if it's an 11-minute half-life, this is a very important topic, half-life, right? So that means every 11 minutes, we're basically going to half whatever our mass is at the time, right? And so the way I do this is I usually write it out like a ladder, right? We have 1 gram here at T0, okay? So at 0 minutes, nothing has happened. Now, if we're in 11-minute intervals, we just write that out. We have 11 minutes, we have 22 minutes, and then finally we have 33 minutes, okay? Because it says 33 minutes, we draw that. So at every step of this ladder, sort of every rung of this ladder, we're gonna half. And so let's do the first rung together. We start at 1 gram, we go down half, we're gonna have 0.5 grams, right? we do that again, we're gonna be at 0.25 grams, right? Half of one is 0.5, half of 0.5 is 0.25. We do that one more time, what do we get? 0.125 grams. And so while I said we needed to focus in on the milligrams, nanograms, milligrams sort of units differences between the answer choices, right? We see the numbers only match one thing, and that's this D, 125 milligrams. So we don't even need to worry about the units in the end because all of the answer choices are different. And so all you do is follow this, the rung of the ladder. See, you go from here to here, here to here, here to here. That's three half-lives. And so if you're able to do that, all you do is sort of half it one by one by one, and you get D. All right, great. Onward to the next question. Question number three. Which of the following best depicts the particle used in experiment two? Is it A, an electron with a negative charge, B, an electron with a positive charge, C, a gamma with a neutral charge, or D, a helium with just a normal helium atom? All right, so an important thing that I did with the answer choices is I recognized what each of these are, right? This is a negatively charged electron. This is a positively charged electron. This is a gamma particle. And this is a helium atom, okay? A normal helium atom. And so with that, you need to be able to identify what types of decay are associated with these particles. And so the first one, I think the easiest, is this one, right? If we're dealing with a gamma particle, we're gonna have gamma decay. Now, what about A and B, right? We're dealing with beta decay. And so remember, there's two types of beta decays. There's beta negative decay, which matches this one. And then there's also beta positive decay, which matches this one, right? If you're decaying into a positively charged electron, then you're gonna have beta positive. If you're decaying into a negatively charged electron, beta negative. All right, and then for two, normal helium atom, what are we decaying into? We're decaying into an alpha particle, or an alpha. This is an example of alpha decay, right? And so having this foundational understanding is very, very important. Sort of what's happening in any decay is we start with X, we end with Y, plus this sort of decaying molecule or particle, right? And that can be alpha, beta, gamma, whatever, okay? And so with that, now we look at experiment two, right? It's talking about experiment two. So let's go over here and look at experiment two. Experiment two is talking about alpha particles, right? It's talking about the reflection of alpha particles. So we need to be able to say, okay, alpha particles, only one answer choice makes sense, and that is D, right? We're saying in experiment two, researchers want to develop a system to detect the reflection of alpha particles. And alpha particles are helium molecules. Awesome. Now we've crushed three out of three. We're on to our final question. All right, question number four. A plane of light hits a mirror at an angle of 37 degrees. What is this angle called? A, Snell's angle, B, angle of incidence, C, angle of reflection, or D, angle of refraction? All right, so this is exactly that same diagram we drew in that first question, right? We needed to say, oh, we have an angle that is coming, light's coming in on, it's going out, or it's refracting in a certain way. So if the plane of light is hitting the mirror at an angle of 37, right? That means that we're going like this. We have our sort of diagram. We're hitting it at 37 degrees, right? And so what did we say this angle was called? The angle of incidence, right? Angle of incidence. So B is our standard answer. But let's go through the other answer choices just to make sure. So first, angle of reflection was the other thing we talked about, right? And that was, it's going to go out this way, and our angle of reflection is this angle, which is also equal to 37 degrees, right? input equals output of the reflection. Now, refraction is when you're changing mediums with your light and the light sort of bends a little bit into a new, I'll use a different color for this one. It sort of bends a little bit into a new sort of angle, right? And so then we have our angle of refraction right here. So I'm gonna write this as angle of refraction. All right, so those are the two angles. And you'll note that the angle of incidence does not have to equal the angle of refraction. It will only equal that if the medium stays the same. And so these answer choices are eliminated. Finally, we have Snell's angle. This isn't a really commonly used term, but you'll note that Snell's law is a very, very high yield formula that's seen on the MCAT relating to refraction and determining angles based on medium. And so with that, you're not gonna have Snell's angle, but I highly, highly recommend you reading into Snell's law that deals with the refraction of light in different mediums. And so with that, we've used our answer from question one to get us the answer choice of question four, and we are 4 for 4, we crushed it. All right, great work team, we crushed another chem phys passage. Kudos for you for getting it done. Lots of great stuff like nuclear chemistry, angles of reflection and refraction, law of reflection, all of that type of stuff. Great job. If you like this video, give us a like down below and subscribe to our channel and comment exactly what type of videos you're looking forward to next so we can cater them to you. Additionally, check out Vikram's 528 strategy series where he goes into depth on all the strategies you need to use to get your highest score possible. And finally, click the link in our bio for the MCAT question of the day so you don't miss out on any studying before test day. Happy studying and let's get it.